So more or less, I try to do everything here except this star as basic as possible, and only to showcase the pipelines without too many external things, which is something that sometimes, at least for me, made it hard to learn TensorFlow because sometimes there are so many things around the code that they want to showcase that you don't know what is what. Okay, very quickly, now we will use the other one from CVS files. We will use as example this data set that's called Iris data set. They're recording, all right?
Sorry?
They're recording?
You're
starting? Okay. The Iris data set that maybe you already saw it because it's in every tutorial that you will see. It's four kinds of flowers, three kinds of flowers, sorry. It's a iris is a kind of flower, and depending of the length of the petals and the sepal, which I don't remember what it is exactly, you get a different species. And the idea is you can use it to classify them and to train model into classifying flowers depending these values that you see here. So the value the file you are going to read looks exactly like this. This notebook downloads it automatically. Same thing. You saw more or less a preview before. One thing that you saw was that this value, when you read it, remember, in the pipeline, you have to set the types. Here we have there is something here. We have four floats, two for the petals and two for the sepals, and one string, the classification, the kind of flower. Now, when you load it with this, it will be automatically converted to these values, no? Casted to floats. And sorry. So here, this example, what it does, I use start again. The first one will be a shuffle, no? Oh, no, sorry, a map. I want to show how to use a lambda with maps. The thing is, let me talk quickly about it. Lambda is a function that allows you in Python, it's nothing to do with TensorFlow, allows you to create functions at execution time, at runtime. And the problem is that sometimes you need to when you use for instance, here, you want to change your labels, that is setosa, versicolor, the name of the flower in a string. Of course, you cannot pass that to a model, to a number, no? And which number we're going to use? The one that is very common, the one-hot encoding. So here we have three classes, three flowers. Then we will represent these classes as 0, sorry, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1, okay? And we have to do this inside of a map because when we do until this point, this is a string, okay? Now when the tuple you are passing of petal, sepal, a string, we have well, a string, okay. You need to do the transformation of string name of the flower to number. I use in this case so an equal in some point that it checks if the value is I don't know flower one setosa, it make it one. Okay, but the thing is that this function needs information extra, external to the that is not on the data set, which is how many classes there are. Because he has all the classes, but he doesn't know which one is 0, which one is 1. We have to tell them. And for that, the thing is that we have to pass arguments to our map. And if you pass arguments to the map, you are a bit well, I won't say a word, but you're in bad luck because when you pass here, map, you don't have the map function of the dataset doesn't have any arguments to give arguments to the function that you are going to use as map. Okay, there is no way to give maps arguments to this function. Okay, you know the problem. It will call it if the function is defined like this. Okay, so it will put everything that is on the data set inside of the function. If you need something extra, you will get an error. And what you use is lambda. And lambda, with that, you can create at runtime a function that you pass the, you can pass first the arguments to the function, to your map function, and then with that you create a second function. I don't pretend you to understand if you haven't used lambda, but I just want to show you because this is something very important and very useful that you can use if you're going to do these kind of things, okay? So takeout is if you need to pass arguments to your map function, you need to create a lambda because there's no way to pass functions to the dataset map. Clear? Okay. So you can you have this. Then you have this in notebook. This means do a bash command. So if you run here, this, it will run this not in Python but in bash in your shell. Okay, and it will download the Iris dataset. And okay, I do an iteration to see what it has inside. You see the labels as we created it. And I want to show here interleaving. But maybe I'll show it later, no? The idea is, here again, this is a block of batch. We create one data set from this one, we grep, and we create one for each flower. So now we have, this is very common, if you download data set that is not yours, that you have different files. And one is one thing, for instance, dog and cats. There is in Kaggle one data set. Then one, you get a file for dogs and a file for cats. So if you put them like this, one after the other one, you will be training on cats for, I don't know, for an hour. And your model is going to get very good to, I don't know, to do nothing because it will never see a dog until some point. Then your convergence is going to be horrible, okay? You need to pass dogs and cats. In this case, we're going to do the same. We are going to divide in three flowers, and we see that we cannot train, we cannot put them like this in line. We have to mix them. And for that, we use this function interleave. Remember that we put orange and purple together. And this is what this is all about. You use interleave, and the idea is that you can play, so here you show how it works. And here you can play different cycle length, different block length. You can put, I don't know, block of, I don't know, three flowers of one kind, three flowers of the other one. It depends what you want to do, okay? Or you want to put one, or the cycle is means that you're going to go over one file, the next one, the next one, like this. If you put three, but if you put two, you're going to do the first two, then you're going to start with the other one and you're going to do some jumps. It's a bit hard to see, to grasp without seeing it, but now you can play. So you don't have to download anything, it's just enter, and here play with these values. And you will see here that from this one that is two and one, you have first flower, third flower, first, third, and then only after a while that I was looping with the cycle two, remember I have three classes, the third one is the one that is. So here we didn't put it like this, or we didn't put it like this. So we put two first and then one behind, okay? Okay, so play with this and did I say the API continuation? This one I show how to use a generator. This one is very simple and very, not really, it's just to showcase how it works. I just generate random data. So anytime you run this, You will get a number, random number, not really useful, but it's nice to showcase the problem. And here you use from generator. This one is very short. Same thing than before. Just print, iterate over it, and see how it looks. You can apply maps, the same thing. This one, I will mention it later, but I had problems to incorporate it to Keras. I don't know if I was doing something wrong or the support is going to come later, but I saw some discussions and I think it's not yet supported. Actually, the support of the data set pipelines to so TF data in Keras, if I'm not mistaken, it started with this version, TensorFlow 1.12, okay? Here, oops, I always forget. Here, this one is about using the shards, which is what I showed before, that the data set goes, so the stream of data goes to device, splits itself to two workers or different workers. In this case, I do it, the notebook does it by hand. This is a fake distribution, no? So you have one cell that runs rank zero. This is fake, it's not really distributed, no? But this is exactly what is happening. It's two different ranks, independent ranks of data. The stream is divided in two workers, and they are totally disconnected, okay? And this one runs the rank one. You see that everything here is one, and everything here is zero. They are not connected, so one is independent. And the thing is that here we read okay, we read two, only two. So, and the thing is that they are very some use cases that you can try here. One is what I was talking about of the cats and the dogs. So, if one is cats and one is dogs, what do you want? You want to mix them in general, no? You don't want to spend 1 hour training in some class without showing the other one, no? This is completely wrong. But now, if you have two data set files that they are homogeneous, so you know, it's cats and dogs in each of them, now you don't need to mix them, no? But now, what would you like? You would like that each of the workers is reading only one of the files. So in this case, like this, you don't need to have two workers reading a same file, each of them, okay? And then with this, with the interleaf, you can do this. You can do that one, and you can see it here, how is printed. Here I'm doing, he's reading only one, the one that has this flower, and this one, the one that has this flower. And the thing is that, so these two use cases, sometimes you want to mix, sometimes you don't want. For two workers, it's fine. You can read two files with two workers, it's no problem. But if you have 1,000 workers reading a single file, there's no need, no? And you can play here with the shuffle, because if you are shuffling with this list files in general, no, by default, we shuffle random, and it may happen that it's this way I did it here, that depending on the shuffle you have, the two data set got the same file, and you are missing one completely, no? And then the idea is you can play with the shuffle, and you can create the use case of mixing and the use case where you don't want to mix, okay? And the final one is oh, come on. Well, this one is a data augmentation. It's similar to Well, it's the opposite of what I showed with the colors. The idea is that you will fetch one image or whatever you want. I do it with images. I will check what is happening later, I don't know. The idea is that you can fetch one image and you can use a map to apply functions, to apply distortions to that image. No? This is very common on image processing. And you can take one image and you can create different copies of the image. One with the color changed, one with the random crops, one with some tilting, you name it. And then you get all these things that you created and you put it together in a TF concatenate and you output to the batch, so to the pipeline, not one, that was the image you got, or depending of the batch size you had, but 10 times or n times the number of images that you had. And then the thing is that we see that we will write batch 2 on the pipeline, but when we print it, we will have batches of 10, because inside we are expanding the data. And the trick, well, not trick, the thing is that you have to do all the, create all the data and then concatenate it and return it as one. So the rest of the pipeline will see it as one example, so as one batch, okay? I don't know why it's like this.
Your location is over.
My location is over? Sorry, I put one instead of 4 hours.
You want to use mine?
No, no, I finished. If you want, you can have a look afterwards when you go home. They are very simple. They are done to really showcase the TensorFlow, and there is no extra dependencies or just NumPy to generate data. But this is like minimal you can use to showcase the input pipelines. I hope it's useful for you. If I find the okay, he found it. So we are a bit.
Questions,
maybe? I don't think so. We are a bit behind schedule, but okay. So this is the next topic. So it's the TF record file system. The TF record file system is what TensorFlow developers, they recommend you to use to store data. So it is a binary format. In general, storing data as binary is better than text. And the thing is, it's called record because normally binary, you have a stream of bytes. You open it by mistake sometimes with Vim, and you see a stream of bytes. But this one is a record oriented, which means that you will have like a collection of bytes. You don't have a stream of bytes. You have like if you know the JSON format, which is like dictionaries or different entries of binaries, and each of these binaries is going to be an item. It's going to be an image or something. In a normal binary, you don't know where the data starts or finish, but in the TF record, it's clear that there are different units. Okay, it's a way to do it, and we'll talk more about this later. And so in our context, deep learning, any of these units is going to be a sample. No? If you have images, you will, I will show you later. Sorry?
Is this done internally through HDF5 or?
No. Well, actually I wanted to talk about this later, but it can be now fine. So this is TensorFlow.
Repeat the question.
Oh, sorry, I have to repeat the question. Could you?
Okay. Sorry.
Now we are recording, I forgot. Okay.
I was asking whether this TF record is organized using HDF5.
Okay, so the thing is, well, no. And this is something called protocol buffers. I don't know if you are into TensorFlow, you have seen it around. Protocol buffer is something can be similar to JSON. It's something to serialize data. So if you have data in memory, in general, you have not only the data, but you have directions. Normally, if you want to, so directions, I'm sorry, addresses of memory. Normally, if you want to write it on your hard drive, on your storage, permanent storage, you need to normally to convert to bytes. This is called serializing, and you store it. And this one is something similar to JSON in the sense that it's like dictionaries. You have, for instance, if you have a data set of images, your entries, if you look at them not in the in bytes but in text, you will get something like I said, image one, then some brackets inside the value of the image, no, the colors, the pixels, the label, another entry, something like that. And I will show now in the you can get, sorry, an allocation for me? Sorry, I got lost. Ah, something important that differentiates it. Okay, that makes it different to JSON. Sorry, is that here you have to pass the information of the data types. So in JSON you put a string, you put numbers, and you don't care if it is float 32 or if it is float 16. And here in this kind you have to put the data. You have to specify, okay, this is a float 32, and I'm going to save it here as a byte. And this apparently is quite quite convenient to recover data fast. And they also, Google also provide a translation because I don't know, the way data is stored or is seen by different languages can be different, and they provide a translation. So if you import it in Python, you can do it in Python with the same file that you can import in different things, and you don't have to create the logic of reading it like a binary you would do, okay? But this is not important for us now, it's just to have an idea. So you read it like this. You have seen this line 1,000 times already. We will go to this one, to this later. But there is something that it will get you scared as soon as we move to the next slide. And also to everybody, I mean, many people is scared about that, which is that it is a bit hard to write the file. It's not, you cannot do like save as TF record, enter, that's it. You really need to specify the data and create some dictionaries and some structure that can be a bit scary at the beginning. But the good thing is that it is a very cookbook recipe. It's always the same. And you pay some price doing this writing of the data in this format, but at the end you earn a lot because now you can use the logic they implement to read the data, and you don't have to care if your generator is efficient or I don't know. This kind of things, you just give it completely to them if you write on TF record, and you know, but for free, well, for free no, you have to write the file, but you will get performance without coding yourself. Okay, the first part of the cookbook, the zero step, is to create. So now we are writing data, so you have. Let's say you want to write one image, single image, and a label, okay? You have it on hard drive, you import it with your favorite software, I don't know, it can be with NumPy, SciPy, whatever you use, OneSciKit, anything, with your own logic. And step zero, you create these three functions, which are more or less like, you can use it as wrappers of types. This one, you will use it to write values, bytes values on the TF record. No. So if you want, if you have an image, you don't, you don't actually write the array with the order of what is what. So you convert it to bytes, so it's like a binary in memory, a stream of bytes, and you pass it here. It's quite simple. And this is always the same, no? So if you have an image, you put it here. If it is an array, I don't know, sound, anything that is structured data, arrays, matrices, anything, you put it here, ping, and that's it. You have it as bytes. And labels also, labels are strings, you also put it as bytes. You also have int64 feature, and you can use it for labels, for labels. If you have integer labels, you can use it. If your label is one hot encoded, you would use this one. If you have setosa versicolor, like the flowers, you put it here. If you have 0, 1, 2, you put it here. And this was for float values. If you are working on regression or something, you have a function with not only classes, but floating point values, real values, you put it here. So this looks ugly, but it's always the same. So you just copy this, paste it on your script, and that's it. You define it your types. And there are only three types. They are not. If your type is 32, you will save it as a 64. If your type is 16, you will save it as a 64. So it's the same, OK? So this is step 0, defining the types. Step 1, you use this function, tfio, record writer. You put the name that you want to save it. And you can use it inside of a width, just to take care of that it is close at the end. Or you can use it directly as you want. You can do writer equal this, but in general you can use this. It's more Pythonic, not TensorFlow, but Pythonic. This is the first step. So second step, you create a. Remember, you are using a. You want to write an image. You create a feature dictionary. I think it's called like that. In the discussions, people call it like that. I'm not sure how internally it's called. But it's a dictionary of features. Remember, this is something a bit, I don't know, a bit abuse of the terms. Because in general, you call features the can be like the many columns your data has, or the length of your samples, but not really your labels. But here you will call features everything, labels, the features, images, everything is called feature. So here you will create something that will be a record on a TF record, but you can picture it as a table, no? You can have these entries, can be like columns in your mind, although they are records in the table. Here you can put, I don't know, the image. We use the byte features we defined before. And we use some logic here. I don't know, I use some scikit image maybe to load it, but whatever you use it, it should have a function like this that will convert your pixels into a string through bytes. You put it here, so this is done by you, this is not TensorFlow. The label, if it is a string, if it's in Python, you can use this function, encode, and you will convert it in bytes as well. And maybe you need some metadata, like the height and the width of the image, so this. And maybe if it is, I don't know, if you can put whatever you want, you can write it here using bytes, so byte features, int features, or float features. So this is whatever you want to write, you use this features, tf train features, that's it. This is a shape. It looks scary, but it's always the same. Okay. Now, so you create something called feature, and you put this feature and you pass it to example. And TF train example is what I said before. It's a protocol buffer. It's like an entry, it's very similar to the dictionary I showed you first, but it's in language of protocol buffer. Okay, that's it. You create a protocol buffer. Of these features, it's pretty much a kind of dictionary, fancy dictionary with types. And remember, you have everything inside of something equal writer. You will see the full thing now. This protobuf, you use this function of the example of the protobufer, serialize a string, and that's it. You wrote one entry. And now, if you want to write a data set, what you do is to do that several times. In this case, completed this, you can loop. Let's say you have a list of images and labels. You can loop over it and just check here. Remember, you're writing records on it. Each record is something independent. So this writer is inside of the for. No? Anytime you loop, you write. Loop and write. And it looks completely like this, no? With this function, TF record writer as writer, you loop, you create here inside your features. With that, you pass it to a protocol buffer. You create the example with the protocol buffer, an entry on the record, and you serialize it to a string and write. And that's it. You have it. And the good thing is that now you do it just once. It's just translating data. You don't need to care for performance, or that doesn't have to be fast. You just run it, and that's it. It's only once you have it. Okay?
If you have a very big data set, do you want to write it all to a single file, or is it beneficial to split it up?
No, actually, after some slides, we will see that. What they recommend, I haven't tried myself, no? But in general, if it is about 1 gigabyte, you can do it together. So everything together should be fine. But now, if it takes many gigabytes, it gets a bit large, they recommend to have a size to split in different files. And each file, they recommend 200, the range of the 100 megabytes, 200 megabytes, 300, from 100 to 300, I would say. And that one thing that was nice with that is the thing of the interleave that I show, that now you can read all of them. You can do it in parallel. You can do, we will see later, if, I don't know, at 7 p.m., I guess. That you can mix them, and then you can get a shuffle for free doing that. And also in a discussion I was reading, somebody was pointing out that if you have to move data to another place, it's easy to, if you have different files, than if you have a whole thing. No?
Can you just repeat the purpose of the third line?
This?
The tf.green.example, why do we need that?
Just a second. Just to finish with this is okay. So remember, each entry on the TF record is going to be a record, and a record is it's like a dictionary. It's actually a dictionary that has types. So this is what I said, that is different from protocol buffer. Well, one of the things that is different from protocol buffers to JSON. So when you create this, you're creating an entry of the record that is exactly this, no? It's the entry height that has the height of the image, the width, the image, and the label. And that's it. And now, if you open a TF record file, you will see that what you have is things like that, entries. Why do you need to create a dictionary? Well, first, this is the format. And the second is when you read it, this is just writing, when you read it, you have all these entries. And now when you read, you can select which one you want to read. Maybe you selected high and width because you're going to do a reshape. But maybe today you don't need to do a reshape. You need a different pipeline that is enough to read the image and the labels. And that's it. You just read the image and the labels. That's why you create so many entries. And the types, you specify it because protocol buffer needs it. And apparently, there are some performance advantage with doing that. Okay?
I wanted to know, which is outside of features, the example, like
Ah, so this one, well, if you really want to know why, I don't know exactly the logic behind, no? You create your features, and your features, you pass it to this functional example, which create the protocol buffer itself. Until this point, this is not a protocol buffer. But when you pass it to example, you create a protocol buffer out of it. Now, why it's not directly, that I don't know. It's the API how it works. And the thing is, you have the example. We will print it on the notebook now, so you can see it. And it looks like human readable, but then you serialize it, and then you get this thing. Oh, sorry. You get the full dictionary, the thing with the entries. You get it converted on a serialized record, okay? On bytes, okay? Now, so this again is a there will be a hands-on, but again you really have to play with it. It's a bit complex, but remember that you gain a lot if you use it. And now reading data is another different adventure. You can use this function to read it. Oh, sorry.
So you mentioned it's a binary, but you also mentioned you can transfer it to other platforms. So it's a binary, but yet cross.
Yeah, because what I mentioned before. Well, remember, it's not only a binary, but this is like a collection of binaries, more or less. If you can entries, and the protocol buffer framework they provide the translation. So if you read it on Python, automatically when you use this function, I don't know, the API they provide, the protocol buffer, they will have one way to read it if you're using Fortran, one way to read it if you're using C, one way to read it if you're using Python. And in such a way you can transfer it and it's no problem to transfer it to different languages or different systems. Also, you have the you know the way how you encode it, and now you, since you know it, you can decode it back using the same technique. Okay.
It's not executable.
Can you pass the microphone? Same line. I think it has to be green.
So you take quite a lot of time to build this TF record, and you may want to put all the features that you can, but in a specific pipeline, you might want to use one or two features out of all of them. Will it impact performance? Like, would you rather have a separate TF record with only two features out of the 10 that you want to actually use? Or if you just want to build one TF record file with 10 features and your pipeline you use only 2 out of 10, is it still fine?
For sure, I cannot, I don't know. I have seen that in general you do it like this. You write everything you have, everything metadata, everything you want to have, as much as you want, and you put it there. And now I really don't know, but it's not hard to find how the protocol buffer manage that. In principle, I guess what you want to do is to put everything. I would say it doesn't affect the performance, but I'm not 100% sure. This is what I have seen, but yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So you mentioned that using this TF record data structures on files will improve performance. So how does exactly TensorFlow take advantage of this specific data format? How does it kind of work intuitively under the hood? How can this, then this, that be utilized to improve performance?
Okay, one thing is the use of the protocol buffers. So this is something I know, have read, it's my impression, okay? It uses protocol buffers that apparently is something quite efficient. You can read extremely fast. It's quite efficient. This is something good. So you use it. You read the data using that framework.
So the protocol buffers are for the I/O.
Yes,
between
yes,
the
yes.
CPU.
I/O transferring data and network, everything that has to do with movement of data in general. And this is something, this is one point. And the other point is that it's done by them. So they know and they are good. It's very efficient. Now, if I do myself a generator to read some kind of other kind of data, I know I'm not very good with I/O. I don't know how is the best way, or simply maybe I don't want to spend 2 months learning the best way to do it. I would do this, and everything, all the I/O is done by TensorFlow and protocol buffers. So it's not, I won't do it bad. Okay, it's not up to me to decide if the reading is going to be good or bad. It's going to be with their optimizations and everything good. Okay,
and are these optimization performed, is there some sort of optimization step for these operations that TensorFlow is doing once it starts to run, or is it just
I think he uses
one
the,
way to execute this graph?
I think so. I think I think Guillaume mentioned it. So when you install TensorFlow, you need to install also protocol buffers, and he will use that as backend to read this. Oh, no, not only that, every data that TensorFlow saves, the graphs, everything sometimes is saved on memory, and everything is done with the protocol buffer. I think everything TensorFlow does, it will save a protocol buffer. Eventually, if you are into it, you will start seeing the .proto files and discussions about it, okay? But I think, so again, those are the two good points. You can use something already performant, which is protocol buffers, and it's not up to you, to your effort, to try to do it as performant as possible, okay? Okay, so now we are reading. Reading is a, okay, sorry. Another question? No. Reading is also, it requires some work, but again, it's only once. And not, it's a cool book. It's not really different. It's always the same. And one thing is that you do it inside of the pipeline. So you read it with this, and now if you read this directly, you will see that you are reading everything, so you are reading all that you put inside and byte data. Byte data. You're not really, you don't have numbers. Now you have to decode all these bytes that you saved. Okay, and so you put it like this. You use a map on your pipeline. I would say on the first one, and depends on what you want to do, and then you continue. Okay. And now everything we see is going to be the definition of the decode function, and then we see the whole thing together. Okay. Okay. The first step, you create a parser, TF parse single example, serializer example. So an example, you know already what is it? It's a protocol buffer. Okay. You're going to read it from the file, no? And here you see I'm only reading image and labels. What you were asking before, I'm not reading everything. I just, maybe for my pipeline, I don't need the width and height of the image. And we pass this and we call it example. This is quite simple, no? You give the you create the parser. This is what you are going to read, no? And so this is going to be the argument of the function, no? And you set these features that most of the cases you use it like this. You use you say that the feature is a fixed length feature. Fixed length means it can be arrays of different length, of different sizes, but it means that it's going to be a single entry on the TF record, okay? So a single record. If you would use, I think, for instance, if you use image recognition, localization of things of image. So you have a cat, and you not only want to say that this is a cat, but you want to say where is the cat. Sometimes you, for the classification, you have many cats or many objects at the same time, a cat, dog, this animal, the other one. You need to pass a list of boxes, of points. So it's here with the box, a box, a box, a box. That case is something that is a variable length feature, maybe. I'm not completely sure now, I don't remember very well. But most of the cases, you would use, if these images, it doesn't matter if they have different size, you will use a fixed length feature, okay? Which means that it's a single feature, not different columns of separate features, okay? Remember, feature here is a bit different to what, I don't know, at least to what I use. Like the length of your array. So features would be different, here it should be different items, no? Like for instance, you have two images, that would be two features. But in general, you save one by one, you use this, okay? And in the worst case, there are only two ways to do it. But this one is most of the case, okay? You use this, here you put the name that you know the tensor, TF record has inside, which you know, you have to know how it was decoded. So you have to know the records, the names. Otherwise, you cannot know. Okay. So we know that from the other one that is called image and label, and they both are a string. This is something a bit weird because before we call it bytes, but now we call it strings. But okay, strings, and now we save that. We fetch that. This is example that we had before. Just, let me repeat. We call this example, so protocol buffer. And now we have the example. The example has two fields, labels and image. Protocol buffer, remember, is like a dictionary. And here you cast it. The labels were bytes. Now you cast it to string. And you can use this function, decode raw, because of the way you encoded it. And you can say, so convert, it's a way of casting, no? Salud. This one was a byte, and you can cast it to int. So normally this one, I did it with an example that the images are values from, it's mnist actually, from 0 to 225 and 250, and then so it was in bytes. We save it in bytes, and now we convert it back to ints, which is what we want. And of course, you need to know the right kind of int, even if you wrote it as a int 64, no? Remember, we created these four types, these three types. In 64 bytes and float, but the original data was on int 8 in this case, and when you put it on, when you convert it to a string, more or less what you're doing is putting everything together. You have like to bytes. You have 8 bytes of data next to the other one, next to the other one. Here, if you put, you don't know, or you made a mistake, and you put 18 int 16, now you're going to get twice. Or if you do the opposite, you're going to get less. That was one of the difficulties I had when I was starting. And the thing is, if they are images, it's very easy, because when you print it, they are, I don't know, you can see weird things on the images, not what you are supposed to see. And together, it's like this. So this serialized sample that we saw before, a bit hanging where to put it, is the argument. Remember, we read the data directly from the file. It will, if you loop over it, if you iterate, you will iterate over serialized examples, over protocol buffers. And now you pass it here to the parser. You create these features, and now the features are called, it's a dictionary. Here I put everything, but it's not needed, as we saw before. And you can cast it to the real values. So the labels are a string, the width is int, it's a number so the size, the length, the array length in both directions, int, int. And this one is int again. Again, remember to have the right int type. And here you can add other things if you want. So in this case, I saved the width and the height because I needed to do a reshape. It depends the shape of what your model is expecting. No? If your model is expecting a line, so just divide one after the other one. So sorry, the values one after the other one. You can finish here with this one. We'll give you a line, but if you want to reshape it into an image, this is a three-dimensional, so RGB image, and then you can return it. And from this point, you can apply maps, filters, whatever you want, okay? Clear? No.
Do you know internally if this is stored as vectors or as records?
Sorry, do you understand?
Are the features stored as columns in the main database, in the TF record?
I will open one now in the hands-on, in the lab. But no, it's if you open it and you see yourself the binary data, you will see something a bit empty without nothing inside written. Sometimes if you open a binary, you see everything. But this one you see nothing, and you see a block of binaries, and then nothing, a block of binaries. And then you can have more or less the idea that those are the records of the TF record. Each of the protocol buffer, actually not protocol buffer, but protocol buffer messages. And you have this association, a collection one after the other one, one after the other, after the other one. Which, yes, apparently I think when you read it, you would fetch a buffer of them, and then you do whatever your pipeline does. But it's not like this. So this high-width image is not written like this, like in a CSV file. So they are one after the other one. Should be like a dictionary. It should look something very, very, very similar to this. It should look like you can picture it like some brackets, one entry of the dictionary, something, or another entry of the dictionary, something like that. You have is it clear?
Yeah, so I guess I don't understand what the advantage of using this serialization format would be over doing something even like pickling it and then storing that in the file.
Yeah, this is what I was discussing with him before, what he asked. If you use a pickle, then you need to read it yourself. You have to write the logic of reading it, and it's not.
You're already writing quite a lot.
Yeah. Yes, but this is boilerplate. It says difference because you tell him cast it like this, fetch this kind of values, convert it like this. So you tell him how to do it, but not exactly what to do. If you use the pickle, then you have to decide with buffers you are reading how the parallelization of the threads operating on the file. There are a lot of points of I/O that they are now in your charge. They are up to you now. And if you are not in general, so many people here, in general, the users of TensorFlow, they come from different. I don't know, research areas, and you generally don't know how to do it. I don't know how to do it, okay? And my recommendation is if you are not a guru of I/O, and you really need the performance, maybe your data set is not worth it, no? But if you really have something big, and you need a performant pipeline, this one is a good thing, because by writing boilerplate, you save yourself writing logic of reading actually how to read parallelization threads a lot of things that I have no idea that they exist, for instance. It's a matter of commodity. You pay this price, and then you don't care because somebody else is writing the logic of reading for you. And also, you can have a look. I have here a link. You can look for protocol buffers, and you can find benchmarks comparing with different other ways of storing data. I'm not really into I/O, I have to say, but at least from the discussions and reading around, it seems that they are quite performant. And it's very hard to reach that yourself if you are not a I/O guru, okay? This is at least my take, okay? And then, okay, so now we're going to do a lab. It's not at 20. Ah, okay. Okay. Then we stop here and we have a coffee. If you allow me, please, a quick coffee and maybe there are some cookies. And we come back, okay?
20 minutes.